for a long time now, we've been talking, Mike and I and Spencer, about changes in golf. And change obviously comes from within. It comes from a mindset. It comes from a change in attitudes and a change in direction, a change in operations and all those things. But it also comes in a change in the product that you're selling, too. And so I'm excited, unabashedly excited to talk about what's coming up here on stage is this new fantasy course we're talking about with Mission Hills. To those who know Mission Hills, just briefly, Mission Hills, there's really, when you say Mission Hills, there's two. There's the Shenzhen Dongquan Complex, which is 12 courses outside the border of Hong Kong, and then the new one, which is on Hainan Island, which is 10 courses. And the previous one, I worked with all the different golf pro signature names. This one, our company did entirely ourselves, all 10. We built all 10 in roughly about a two-year period, all on lava rock. So it posed a lot of issues, but one of the things going in, and to be honest, when we first talked about getting going, it was much more than 10 courses, but we've focused in on 10 courses. And the 10-course complex in Haikou, when you're given the directive of producing multiple courses like that, obviously, if you like Pine Valley, you don't want to build 10 Pine Valleys. If you like Augusta, you don't want to build 10 Augustas. And so before we even got into talking about what we did on an individual basis, one of the things we did early on was to start to kind of categorize golf courses. So and the staff, we went through, started pulling out photos from a lot of different golf publications off the internet, and we started kind of categorizing. These are photos that have an Augusta style. This is a Pine Valley style. This is a National Golf Links. This is a that. And try to come up with different styles of courses, not just in looks, not just in bunkers, but style changes, not just in the look of the golf course, but even to the scorecard. Some courses, Blackstone, for instance, which is the tournament course, can stretch all the way to 7,800 yards. And then we have three golf courses, which are par 70, 6,200 yard courses, just nice little resort experiences that are still have a sensory overload about them. So, in doing all this categorizing of golf courses, one of the categories, so to speak, that came up was something we coined at the time was the term icon course. And largely done from those who kind of in architecture circles, there was a designer years past by the name of Desmond Muirhead did a lot of wacky stuff, which I'll show you. So we started to define that as one of those options. And we had a long story, but we had another property that we were going to do that on. That kind of fell through. So what we've done, what we're doing right now, we're taking one of the 10 courses and remodeling it into what we're about to see some of today. Hope I'm going the right way. Okay, so part of this research thing was to go through and see what was kind of done in the past. And there are a lot of, this is an old Stanley Thompson course with a Chinese reference, there's dragon and ball. There's the Lone Star State in all its splendor, deep in the heart of Texas, serving as the green and of course in Minnesota years ago. And then there's a lot of contemporary work. This is a Fazio course with the green monkey. Is the hole there. Here's another one in Washington. Washington, of course, famous for its apples, and so they put this iconic image into the course itself. A Dungeness crab outside of Seattle. This is a big foot paw print on a relatively new course in Minnesota. So you can see there's a lot of things that have been done in recent years that play off the same kind of concept, but in my opinion, a lot of these have kind of scratched the surface. And they've gotten a lot of attention, but they've dipped their toe in the pool, but they haven't really taken the full plunge. Desmond Muirhead is an architect, had a land planning background, was involved in, spent time in the Army, got involved with Jack Nicklaus in the planning of Muirfield, and went on to do a lot of things as an architect, and then came back kind of after a self-imposed hiatus and came back with a lot of really, really wacky ideas. One of the ones that he was most famous for is this mermaid hole in Florida. Of course, a lot of people have seen this image. This is, I think they called it Jaws, which is an island green with an island bunker coming from this elevated tee. This hole no longer exists, by the way. I think, as you might imagine, I think the members had trouble with this design. he did a lot of mythology. This is in Japan. Again, really a lot of imaging on the golf course, but done with, and this is an important point I'll get to, done with the landforms itself, done with the with turf, with bunkers, with normal golf course elements, but done in a manner where it projected a different image. These are some of his designs. Again, mystical, wacky kind of things like that. And some of the issues with some of these, they look great in plan view. When you draw them, they look great. But as a golfer sees them, you don't necessarily visualize things the same way. Okay, for the squeamish in the crowd, you can leave. But this is another, some more Desmond Muirhead stuff. You know, kind of an obvious target to go after. This was, I don't know what he called this one at the time, but the idea of the female form but put into the ground. It's actually, it's not really just attributed solely to Desmond Muirhead. There are a lot of designers have done this kind of thing or sketched out this kind of things in years gone by. Another point is that not just golf architects, building architects. This is an office building in Ohio. They sell baskets. What better imaging for your building to promote the fact you sell baskets? Here's a library in Kansas City. The facade of the building is a stack of books, which does another thing, too. Not only does it promote the concept of what's being promoted or sold or provided in the building, but it's one of these things that I'll get to also is it messes with your mind in terms of sense of scale. Performing Arts Center, do it with a musical instrument. This is some friendly alien in somewhere. This is one of my favorite ones. I go through the, and I don't know how many go through China all the time, but Chongqing. This is the airport in Chongqing, and it's very subtle, and that's what I like about this one, is this is the terminal, but it's the inside of an airplane. It's the same shape, it's got the same luggage compartments. You can kind of see off to the side, but it's got the round windows, but it's the same image of walking down the fuselage of a jet. And but it's in massive scale. Again, it's taking something and take it to a different scale. Obviously, the Luxor in Las Vegas. Here's a seashell house. Again, getting to manipulating scale. Stuff like this. And again, this is real true earth forms, and then this massive clip that's pinched it, and even physically looks as if it got collected that way. I like the razor on the grass, the liquid pen painting the stripes on the street. Again, just messing with scale. These are buildings. So what we started getting into is how do you apply that to golf and bring the imaging to a different level? I'm not getting any kind of action here. Okay. Another thing that gets a lot of talk is beyond the product itself is kind of fun alternatives to how you play golf. There's the big cup, putting courses, snag golf, trying to get, and of course, we've all grown up on mini golf. And so I was coming at it as how do we go about bringing the real game of golf, but bringing the element of fun, bringing the element of design and sense of scale and different imaging, but keep it real and keep it as a golf course. There's a story behind this one. This is actually, I just found out in the last couple days, this is in Australia. They're holding the Australian PGA on this golf course this week. And it's a big controversy because evidently the developer made the deal to hold the event and then came in with these things and unbeknownst to everybody. So it's going to be on TV evidently. So. And the funny thing about that is when I talk about doing all these things, and not just in design, but a lot of times, a lot of the stuff has to do with operations. If you can go past through the kind of the part about mini golf. Good. The funny thing is that when I talk about this, and I talk to a lot of different people about whether it's design or operations, and I always kind of make the point that you know, maybe you should think about, you know, the business model changing some and bringing something else to it. And we've talked about fun and golf and different alternatives. And the one thing I always say, the one statement I always ended with is, you know, the one place doesn't need to do anything is Augusta. You know, they don't need a membership drive. They don't need to do anything. They're just fine. And then to have that thing come out and, of all courses, use Augusta, the last place that needs any help. Here's another one here, and you can turn the sound down on this one. So given all that, this is a video, a little skee ball competition. Ricky Fowler sporting the stash. I wanted to show this because this kind of is what I'm somewhat talking about, but it's also exactly not what I'm talking about. Because here's the deal, and it's sure it's all fun and games. This is, they're showing up to hit balls from this island tee to a skee ball. Which I don't know how many are familiar with that game. We all played it in the States where you roll a little ball into it. And this is all fun and games and it's all that. And, you know, and Lexi and Rick are hitting balls. But what I think is important and what I've been pushing is that we can incorporate the fun, you can incorporate the images, you can port the scale. But it's so important that it still has to be real golf. It has to be a real golf club with a real golf ball on a real tee, hitting to a real fairway with real sand, hitting to a real green, holing out on a real putting green to a regulation-sized cup. It's just that the stuff that you encounter along the way takes on a different image, takes on a different look, a different feel. It's still the game of golf, however. And so what we did is, and there's kind of two reasons for doing this. I went to Mission Hills, and I said, you know what, this is great. And we had a heap of ideas. And you know, beer-induced ideas, and came up with a number, and I said, you know what, it would help to kind of, it'd be nice to kind of solicit a lot of ideas from other people throughout the globe, and at the same time, kind of promote what we're doing to get the word out, even before the project's even done. So we had a contest that we took out to the internet, we took out to some publications, and came up what we called, right now, the name of Icon course had been changed to the Fantasy course, the Fantasy Golf course. So we put out just to the world, send us some entries for the wackiest golf hole you can think of, and we're going to have a winner for the par 3, winner for par 4, winner for par 5. So we got a lot of contest applications from all over the world. This is a panda hole, this is a rocket ship, this one was hard to figure out. People gave us detailed scale graphics and models and really went to a lot of work on it. I never figured this one out, but it had good graphics. Long swords that you played around. I thought the one on the far right with the dancers was interesting, but it was one of those ones that, again, it looks good in plan view, but it's not necessarily something that's going to pick up from the golfer's eye as he or she plays the course. So, but again, we just had a number of entries all over the world. This guy in particular did a few, had wonderful graphics. The one on the left is obviously the continents. It turns into this golf hole that again is a nice concept, but it didn't really work. The par 3 has these fountains that pop up. So as you're standing there hitting the ball, all of a sudden your ball could get knocked down by water. Courses that took the roll of the ball into consideration or odd bounces. I think the one on the bottom right here is where you were supposed to play it off the back of a building and have it bounce. You get it over the wall, bounce it off the wall, then have it come back to the green. Things like that. Rice paddies. And a lot of it was iconic images of China. People have, a lot of people have seen this. This is the noodle bowl. These are the ones that we kind of came through, the winners. The Noodle Bowl was the par 3 winner. Great Wall was the par 4. And this Mayan ruins themed kind of course was the par 5 winner. And another reason for doing this contest, too, was not only to solicit ideas from around the world, but it was also to kind of keep me at arm's length, where I could kind of protect my image as being a real golf course architect, but at the same time facilitating the desires of Mission Hills and what they wanted to do. And because I had run this idea past the chairman, the late chairman David Chu, and he was just all over it. And so he passed away a little over a year ago. And so I've made it one of my main goals in life to see this thing through, it really in his honor to make sure it gets done. So we had this contest. The Noodle Bowl was an interesting. This is the original contest entry, where the chopsticks stuck out of the bowl and you teed off from the chopsticks down to the green, and there were floating noodles in the bowl. And I loved this one. I thought it was wonderful. I thought that it essentially, as far as really, really thinking something wacky, this one really pulled it off. What I thought this one needed, though, however, was I felt instead of teeing off on the chopsticks to the green, I really thought it was better to be on the tee and see the whole image there in front of you. See the island green, see the chopsticks, and so it's all in one view, rather than having portions. So I just started playing around with a lot of different sketches, how to make this work. Because one of the things, too, is it's easy to come up with an idea, but it's another thing to physically construct it, another thing to physically be able to maintain it, and it's another thing to have people really be able to see it. So there's a lot going on. So I started playing with a lot of different sketches on how that could work. And at that point, we got Andrew Harris. Andrew's going to come up here afterwards and show some crazy videos that he does. And one of the guys in his room, and I had brought this up to Mission Hills, because those of you who do go travel in China, it's kind of taboo, forbidden. You're not supposed to put your chopsticks into your bowl. And so I had run it past, and then Andrew's guys brought it up again, and said, are you sure that we want to have the chopsticks second? Maybe they should be laying on the bowl. So we ended up with this, where those are actually 70-meter-long chopsticks on the side of this bowl. Now, the thing is, you hit from a grass tee to a grass putting green, the hole is no different than 17 at TPC, which is the island green that everybody in the world knows. You hit from a tee to the same yardage to an island green with turf, and you're surrounded by a lake. Well, it's really the same shot. It's the same thing going on. It's just that, again, the imaging that goes around here is literally a noodle bowl with floating noodles and massive chopsticks on the side. So you can make the argument that it still is golf. It's just that instead of having pine trees around the golf hole, it has the images of noodle. Great Wall was one that the original concept came in. And obviously, when we first played around, we had a Great Wall. And so what we liked about this one is that because we're remodeling one of the existing courses, we're basically taking one of the existing courses, I was trying to retrofit, not only make all these deals work, but how do we make it fit on this course in specific on a hole-by-hole basis? And so there was one hole where this whole idea of the wall works, and Lord knows we got plenty of rock to work with there. The place is on lava rock, so we're going to create these walls out of rock. So we take the imaging of the Great Wall. These are some sketches I did. These are actually real sketches or real photos of the golf hole today, laying in how that might work in terms of scale, how to integrate it in. So this is an animated version that Andrew's office did, but this essentially is the golf hole today. There's lava fields is actually to the course to the right, but this is on the course that we call Meadow Links. But it's basically a little left to right par four with bunkering up the right side, not as much as what's shown on here. But basically, it's surrounded by jungle today. And so the idea is that, again, if you keep that concept of it's the same golf hole, it's the same thing, you're playing golf, but rather than palm trees surrounding the golf hole, it's the Great Wall. And I've always also made the point, too, that, and I was talking with Dave Dale, architect friend of mine who's here this week, if you were given a site and part of the property was this piece of land which had a piece of the Great Wall, and the owner said, oh, by the way, and if you want, you can throw that into the golf. I mean, who would not build this golf hole? So I think you would see that hole built if that feature existed today. So again, getting back to the argument that it still is real golf, it's just that the features that surround the scenery are different. I think this is a nice image here. It literally has the wall to the left, crosses the fairway, we'll crumble it down, something like this, and then it wraps back and around. Richard, this is another contest winner that was this kind of Mayan-themed, where he took these images of And again, with the lava rock, we can build these. So for me, it was an easy solution. And again, the golfer still plays the golf hole, still has a tee, still plays through. But rather than being a design that you have to be in a helicopter to see, whenever you go up with a feature, you see it. And while we're looking at this, getting back to that point I made about Desmond Muirhead things before, where the majority of those features were in turf. They were in natural materials. They were in turf, sand, things that you could shape into a specific shape. What we're looking at here is taking it to the point where we're starting to introduce hardscape. You're starting to introduce buildings and in things that stick out of the ground. They're not made of natural materials, although this was a combination of stone and plant. So again, you know, if you put your hand up and blocked your eye and you saw the right side of that photo, it's a golf hole. But what you're playing around is this. Now, at the same time, if you came across this, if you were handed this site, Howard, if someone handed you this site and this thing was here, would you not play a golf hole around it? So it still is real golf. In this case, the tee, you actually go up to the top and you tee off the top as well, too. Panda hole, obviously, you know, a lot of these images that we had early on were meant to kind of replicate the images of China, so to speak. So obviously, panda is a easy target. So this is again, this is a sketch I had done. This is actually a photo of the actual hole and put the paw bunkers and then the panda face behind the black the nose, the eyes, the ears are made out of black lava rock. But actually, I wish I had. I was just there last week and the hole is done. And I didn't get the photo together to put it into play. So we did some played around with some different sketches and how to make it all work. But that one's, the funny thing is this hole, when you stand on lava fields, and lava fields is one of the better courses, I think my favorite of the 10. People are teeing off now and they see this hole down the left side and they're all just crazy. Like, what is that? What is that? What is that? And it's starting to really create a buzz. We have the shape of bamboo bunkers. The tees are actually paws. You see the toenails. The tee is a big paw shape with big toes coming out with toenails like that, made out of the rock. Casino hole, again, the images of casino. This is a course in Las Vegas on the far right there. It's called Legend something, which is the cards, all the suits of cards that are used for the tee shapes. And everybody, I remember when this first opened, everybody thought that was so crazy and so wacky, and everybody wanted to go play that golf course because those tees had that shape to them. And again, what we're talking about is taking this to a whole nother level. So in this case, I'm getting no love here. There we go. So I started. So it, you can see on the left the kind of the diagram. It's a short drivable par four where the tees are the same. It's the clover and the diamond and the spade. And you go through and then they're mahjong tabs and the hole rubs around and then there are actually dice up by the green that stick out of the ground. And that what you hit over though is a roulette wheel, and hopefully it's going to spin. We're still struggling with that one, but it's a drivable. So it's literally a gambling hole, where you can hit the tee shot up and over the roulette wheel. Road rally hole, there's a hole. Obviously, any architects in the office, you know, you build a golf hole and you do all you can to get the cart path out of the way because you don't want to see it, you don't want to have it come and play, you don't want to have balls bouncing off the cart path and going into weird places, and cart paths are the bane of every designer's existence. It's always the big problem. We spend 20% of our time probably, you know, trying to get rid of cart paths. This one's the opposite. The cart path goes right down the center of the fairway, where if you are able, you can hit this road and you gain distance. So as you get to the tee, there's stacks of tires painted the different colors. All this racing imaging that goes on, and then then you can see that the road itself goes through. So the closer you hug those bunkers, you hit the road, and you might get another 50 yards off of it. And then the big tire thing that they always drive through, we'll put that way, that's somewhere down through the course, so you have to encounter that along the way, and you can play under it, over it, whatever. Bird's nest is another iconic image of China. Everybody knows that building. It's the national stadium. The idea is to create a green site where you actually, it's a hole where you have to put yourself in position, and then you actually loft it up and over, and you might see the top of the pin, but it's surrounded by the images of that building. Terracotta Warriors is the next one we're getting into. We're under construction right now. This is the next one we're getting into. We actually have bought, I think 500 full-size, full-scale Terracotta Warriors that are going to be down in an existing, you can see on the right there. This is an existing golf hole that we're really not changing anything. It's already an existing down rocky low area, and we're just going to clean all that out and set the Warriors all marched in unison. Waterfall, this is a hole where the golf hole, from the moment you drive to the tee, the whole imaging is like an Indiana Jones movie, where it's a jungle theme, and not only is it sensory overload, not only is it what you see, but there'll be bird sounds and smell and all that, so you come into a totally different environment. And in this case, you walk into a cavern and you hit out from a cavern and cantilevered out the front, there's a waterfall. So there's water dribbling. So you hit from behind a waterfall to start the golf hole. And what it has, you can see the tees off to the left. There's a big snake that dips down and through, goes around the back, and behind the green is a big snake. All that would be a natural landforms and covered with different plant material to imitate the markings of a snake. This is one of my favorite ones. One of the things, and this kind of goes back to when I grew up in Pebble Beach, right by Spyglass, by Cypress and Spyglass, and we used to sneak on the courses, and in waiting to sneak on the courses, waiting for the groups to clear, we'd be in the bushes. And when they built that golf course, there was an extra piece of about 2-meter pipe, like drain pipe, storm pipe, that they'd kind of rolled off into the trees and never dealt with. It was too hard to get out of there. So while we were waiting for groups to come through, we used to try to hit one irons. Remember the days of one irons. Hit little one irons to try to hit it through that pipe. And so I always thought it'd be cool to do something where you have to hit through something like that. So the idea here, and this is again messing with kind of the idea of scale, is the tees are actually indoors. Something that's not along the lines, unlike the lines, like the third of this building, it's 8 meters, 8 meters, and I think it's 36 meters long to match the proportions of a sleeve of golf balls. And you actually walk into a building and it's arched and you actually hit out this tube. And that's how you start the hole, is hitting out this tube. And then there's golf ball imaging that goes along the way. And what it does, too, is, and you can see the center thing, you can see the sleeve of golf balls. Another one where it messes with the sense of scale, but there's another point here, and there's a lot of things going on in this golf course beyond what we've talked about today. The other thing that it opens the door for is corporate sponsorship. And we've talked with a lot of different corporate sponsors on a lot of these holes so far, but in this case, you have the ability to go to a Nike or an Acushnet or whoever, TaylorMade, and they can sponsor this golf hole, pay X, and every time they launch a new product, they're able to show it and advertise it on this golf course. And they can, just as if you would put a new billboard out on the highway, this tee box and its enclosure becomes a billboard, it becomes advertising. And free advertising, because when this is all said and done, I think everybody on the planet is going to know about this golf course. This was an early sketch for a concept hole where we call it the volcano. Obviously, we're on volcanic rock. But you again, getting back to the idea that you hit from turf with a golf club, golf ball, everything's the same, from turf to green. In this idea, in this concept, there was it's a real shot. You can hit from here to there. Now, it'd be a really, really difficult, let's say it's a 7-iron, into a tiny little target surrounded by death. I mean, there's rock and all kinds of stuff. So you really do have there's a big risk taking that shot. Now, the other one is actually hit it over to this big area over here, which, in keeping with the volcano theme, it's a big built-up area, and you can actually, you just hit like a little wedge into it, and you hit it into this big gaping hole, and once it goes in there, as we've all played mini golf, there's a pipe that rolls to the green, so you can actually roll the ball out to the green as an option. You can take the real true hard shot, or you can hit it there and let it roll there. And one of the things with well, actually, and then on this one too, I always felt it would be good to have four options, where three of them are pipes that go to the green, and one is a pipe that comes back to you, and you see the ball go boom, 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 off the rocks. So there's some risk involved in it. These are volcanoes that are actually built at the facility today. And getting back to the facility, in addition to the 10 courses, it's a full-size family resort. It's got a massive spa, the biggest on the planet, and they really are catering to kids, to families. And so part of the idea on this is you're going to get the purists who say, this is crazy, this is wacky, this isn't real golf. But what we're banking on is that you're going to get a lot of families who come here, and this may not be where they're going to host the U.S. Open, but it's a place that the kids are going to want to play. And what kids don't want to go play some of these holes with some of this imaging? Getting back to the idea of corporate sponsor, this is another one with big sense of scale. So one of the things, it's funny, is I've spent all my time, all this career, I've spent all these years trying to get to the point, doing all this work I can, and I've had friends in the business who have scolded me and told me that I'm going to ruin my reputation, I'm ruining my career, this is career suicide, and this is the craziest thing that you'd ever want to do. And I keep telling them that I honestly believe that it's going to be a very successful business venture, and being associated with a 10-course complex, this, by the way, is Blackstone, but be associated with a 10-course complex, it's like a menu in a restaurant. You have fish, and you have poultry, and you have beef, and you have foie gras, you have all these different things. You know, it's macaroni and cheese. You may not want that. You want this. You don't have to play this golf course. There's nine other golf courses to play. So given that philosophy, you know, if it was your only golf course, it'd be one thing. But the fact that it's this big complex, and it's just a choice, and when it is a family-oriented complex on top of that, again, I think that what you'll find is that a lot of people will go out of their way to go there. And so from a professional point of view, I've not been concerned about what it would do to my, you know, reputation and, oh my God, the guy's gone wacky. And again, I'm involved in pushing it and on board because I feel that I owe it to Mission Hills and to the chairman who had envisioned this happening and seen this through. This is actually lava fields. Of course, we're talking about is just to the left. Noodle Bowl will be to the left of, this is 18 on lava fields. But you can see the land we're dealing with. So again, I'd like to continue to be known as someone who does, you know, regular work, regular golf courses, and all that more Mission Hills stuff here, and not as this wacky person. Because the last thing I want to be known is someone who's wacky. So, at any rate, that's the end of that. Andrew, he's going to come up here and show you some videos on three of the holes that are just really crazy, crazy good. But I'm really excited about it. I think that as a business model, it makes a lot of sense in this 10-course complex. I don't know what it does for the future of golf. On a lot of hands, I see it like a fashion show. You know, we all see on TV, you see the fashion show, and you see the Lady Gaga-looking woman, you know, models walking down the runway, and they've got hair shaped like a helicopter, and they've got, you know, these dresses strut all over, and they've got three-foot-long hot pink fingernails or whatever, and all these people applaud and think it's so great. And, of course, none of that ever really gets applied to everyday fashion, except they'll pick up a little thing, and they say, oh, yeah, I liked those fingernails, not that they're 2 foot long, but I liked the fact they were hot pink. And the next thing you know, hot pink is the big thing in fingernails. And so this isn't the answer. It's not the answer to whatever problems golf might have today in trying to get more new players. It's just an answer. It's one solution that makes sense for this project. And if any little bit, any little elements, even if just having different tee markers on your course, that have something to do with the project, or have something to do with the region in general, that gives the image the course a different image and feel. Subtle things like that can make a difference. So, like I said, we're not dipping our toe in the pool on this one, diving full in, and it's going to be over the top. And I'm happy it's going to be over the top, and I hope that it does something that brings some new fun, new creativity, brings new people. If the purists squawk. but it gets families down and it gets new people interested in playing the game. I'm all for it, and I hope that, you know, we're under construction. I hope to have it all done roughly within 2 years' time, and hope to all see you there, hitting it back from behind the waterfall someday. Thank you.